you know, as a writer, was to try to get a script there. I had a lot of help from Guy Fournier, my executive story consultant. He's a guy I've worked with in Quebec. He's a terrific writer himself, but he's also, he knew Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, for 40-some-odd years, before his years in power, during and after. So I felt really comfortable knowing that I could always turn to Guy and say, you know, am I totally out to lunch here? Did this make sense? And so he helped keep us on the rails.
I believe that it's very important for any period film to somehow suggest a period in and of itself, in the very fabric of the movie. I like the film to feel as though it was made in that period, not that it's about that period. So my film covers 67 to 81, which is several different periods. So in going over the script, I saw that just by chance, the script very nicely fell into 4 one-hour chunks, if you will. So I thought I would model each hour on the work of a single director whose films were both visually recognizable and of the period, and whose content blended social criticism and human relations. So for the first hour, it's Richard Lester. Now I know the first thing we think of is The Beatles and Hard Day's Night and Help. And yeah, there are some jokes and references like that in the film. But beyond that, Lester did some amazing mid-60s films like The Knack and The Bed Sitting Room and Petulia and How I Won the War. So we drew from all those. The second hour, which is a political drama, is Costa Gavras, specifically his film Z, 1970.
Look, I hate to bring this up, guys, but the Governor General's parliamentary ball is tomorrow night. Maybe we should ask him to cancel.
We'd be playing right into their hands. If something happens to Mr. Cross, well, then we'd have to consider it. But if not, I don't want them to think they can disrupt normal affairs.
The third hour, which is male-female relationships and politics, well, that screams Bernardo Bertolucci, the conformist, and Locomotive Seca, and Before the Revolution, and Last Tango, I guess.
You go this way, and I hear your first line off camera, and that's what makes the camera turn around, and I stop here on a wide shot to see the bed and you there, like that.
I thought I'd be just doing a little bit.
Everything I do, they hate.
And the final hour, which is really about words, it's and people sitting around and debating great emotional issues based on words and documents, that's Alan Pakula. So what I did was create a document of all 4 hours in which I had a breakdown of every scene, and in this document I broke it down into the large four directors' sections with all the notes as to what the company has to be preparing for each section. And then within each section, then further broke it down so that we could chart the dramatic, emotional and production aspects of the film. So this document was issued to everybody in the crew and everybody in the cast. But while you're shooting, you've now got this document as a reference. So when you're doing that scene tomorrow, you can look at this document, and not only do you know what you have to prepare, but you also know what the meaning of that thing is, whether you're preparing a performance or you're preparing a prop.
Why so many cameras?
Well, Trudeau was followed by by a media troop at all times, you know, just like any prime minister or leader of the country is. So, you know, anytime he goes outside, there's a scrum going on. So it's all period stuff. So we've got late 70s, mid 70s, early 80s film, you know, basically in the time zone of this film shoot, we went from when they shot news on film cameras to when they shot it on video. So we've got everything to sort of slowly show that transition over time.
Pierre Elliott Trudeau become so popular that you begin to oppose him.
I think we can start opposing him today. And I know I can count on you guys to help with that.
I was fascinated, I've always have been, by the October crisis. Because we know what happened on the streets. We know what the academics think. We know what the journalists think. What we don't know is what went on in the cabinet room. And I was aware of the fact that the cabinet documents were going to be released in the spring of 2001. And I thought, you know, that could be interesting, is to see what the October crisis was like from inside Parliament Hill. But then I realized if you only make a film about Trudeau and the October crisis, it really doesn't, that's part of him. That's not, you know, enough of him to really do him justice.
Providing we tell the opposition we're doing it this way so we don't tip anyone off.
Now look, we're trying to prevent a civil war here. Stanfield needs to understand that.
One of the dangers of a director wearing a suit to work all the time is that it seems like he's showing off or being pretentious or trying to intimidate the cast and crew through wardrobe and not through the power of his or her vision. So I knew that was always the risk. And I was very happy that when I walked on set that first morning, all the cast and crew burst into big smiles. And they loved it. And they all told me, said, this is great. It's really setting the right tone. And we're really happy you're doing it. It wouldn't have worked on a different movie. I think everybody knew the kind of film they were working on. So my plan paid off, that me dressing like that sort of gave the whole set, not the movie, but the set, a kind of a living, walking symbol of what we're trying to do. One of the main reasons I took this gig, you know, when I was reading this, reading through the script finally that Wayne sent me, you know, across, you know, scene four, exterior Tahiti Beach, and I thought, cool, I get a trip to Tahiti out of it. And then, of course, you know, you're going to have to build Tahiti and Halifax. You know.
What were the challenges for the art department?
Wow. Immense. Two different periods. Huge numbers of people and locations and not enough money, as usual. We owe a huge debt of gratitude to our production designer, Jennifer Stewart, who did a magnificent job. Everybody in the art department did a fantastic job. Martha Creator, costume designer, just worked wonders. A whole bunch of them. I think it shows on screen. Every penny on screen.
Alright. Can we move this group a little bit to the side and let the others move? Yeah. Okay, people that didn't get a chance to do that.
The first person on the team that I really spent time working with was Dean Soltis, my brilliant editor on this. He happened to be in Toronto doing something else at the time, so we got a chance to spend several days looking at the script and looking at the movies and images and things and discussing it. And one of the things we realized is we needed stock footage as a deliberate creative escalation of the story. It can't make the movie look cheap. It can't make the movie look like, okay, they couldn't shoot this crowd scene, so here's stock footage of a crowd, that kind of thing. And so it has to be used to augment as a kind of a chorus or as a visual punctuation. So it was a very careful line that we had to walk.
3 months before pre-production even started, Wayne, David, and Jerry sent me off to Toronto to start combing through CBC's stock footage, and Roy Harris and Helena were a big part of that. We spent about 8 hours a day, starting with about 1,100 hours of footage, and we narrowed it down to 200 hours, and June Bork, my assistant, had a lot of fun loading and taking care of all that stuff for me. What we were trying to do is find enough stuff that we could work into the show, because we knew we couldn't shoot a lot of the big crowd stuff, and that's how we incorporated split screens into the whole deal to make it stand out on its own, so it wasn't making it look like we were trying to shoot this stuff.
Okay, so what we're doing here for you youngsters is we're recreating the riot at the Saint Jean Baptiste parade in Montreal in 1968. This was the night before the federal elections at which Trudeau was elected for the very first time. On this particular night, in a park just across the street over there, there's about 1,000 young people who are separatist rioters.
We were never going to be able to restage the Saint Jean Baptiste parade riot. We just don't have the bodies, the bucks to, you know, it's impossible. So we needed to find a way to use what existed and weave in what we could actually do. And I think Jerry did an absolutely brilliant job of bringing that to life.
I'm shooting on the building. I'm going to tilt down off the top, revealing all you lovely people. And I'm going to cue this float to go by the camera, by you. It's going to look a lot better on film. And then I'm going to yell, volley. When I yell volley, my lovely assistants here will throw a couple of rocks and bottles at you.
I think one of the major reasons we got Jerry, other than his fine body of work, is Jerry brought a different sensibility. He did not come from that generation. He doesn't suffer from the, rightly or wrongly, the same kind of sentimentality that many of us do. Many of us grew up in that period of time and have certain views of it. He brings a contemporary sensibility, I think, to the subject matter. And Wayne, I think, made a convincing argument we ought to go that way. So between them, Jerry, and then the casting, which I think so far has been brilliant, you know, Colm is a natural, you know. We're very, very, very pleased about Polly.
Yeah, Maggie was a very difficult thing to cast because everybody had their eye on Maggie more than any other role. It's funny, you know, to do a Trudeau, to do a movie about Trudeau is really to do a movie about Maggie, it seems, in this country. Every other character seemed to be taken care of. Yeah, you want to cast this person for that role, fine, go ahead. But for Maggie, everybody wanted to put their 2 cents in, because we've turned her into this incredible myth. It's funny, you know, everybody asks about Maggie right off the bat.
I read both of her books, and I watched tape on her. I read everything I could on her. I talked to 1,000 people about her. Everyone, as soon as it was announced that I got this part, every single person that I met had some story or something to say about her or their opinion or something like that. And it was sometimes very useful. I had to grow up in the miniseries. You know, I started at 19 and I had to go basically till early mid-30s. And I had 3 children along the way, and I was, you know, the wife of the Prime Minister. What I'm trying to say is, he's taught me everything that I know about being a loving person.
Coots was sort of the guy who was able to stand up to Trudeau. If he thought Trudeau was really getting out of hand, he would tell him. He'd basically tell him to his face. You know, he'd close the door and then he'd say, you know, you're out of control. You're out of hand. Get it together. And so they have done a bit of a build in terms of that. You see Jim Coots being incredibly loyal to Trudeau and a big believer in what he was trying to do and a big fan of what he was trying to do. but at the same time getting a little impatient, a little frustrated with his arrogance and his apathy sometimes. And there is a scene in it where he finally basically lets him have it in a hallway. You know, the rest of us are taking this very seriously, and you're just shrugging your shoulders and walking away. So grow up and get on the horse. And so that was kind of a fun moment to play with Colm.
288 Alpha, take two.
Mark, please.
Mark.
Right.
And action.
Is there anything you didn't already know?
I know.
Well, 4-1 vote, the executives want your back.
I'm not convinced.
What more do you need? What are you afraid of, losing?
I'm not afraid of losing.
Good. You lose the election, you're right where you are now. You win, you fight the referendum as prime minister of this country. Because Levesque thinks he can win.
And you're not some retired ex Paul.
Cut. Pretty good.
Cut. Thank you.
We had this very interesting discussion prior to the first day of shooting in Ottawa. And a couple of actors were there, and we sat around a table with Jerry, the director, and a few, you know, people working on the set. And Jerry sort of started by saying what drove him to do the series and to agree to direct it, and then he asked each of us to express our feelings about the series. And it was very interesting because we each had a different opinion about the series, about our involvement in the series. And Raymond Cloutier, who is also from Montreal, who plays Pelletier, was sitting next to me. And as Quebecers, we had our attitude and our feelings were totally different. And I thought that was interesting. So, and I think it created a bond between all of us.
And out of the Quebecois actors, you know, some of them said, okay, well, now that we're talking, I got to tell you, I'm a nationalist. I hate Trudeau. I'm playing Trudeau's best friend and a big supporter of Trudeau. And I'm going to do it because I'm an actor and I want to be in this movie. But personally, I'm a nationalist and I have severe problems with the actual history. And another Quebecois actor would say, well, actually, I'm a Federalist. I don't have a problem with Trudeau. I'm a big admirer of him. And then those two would get into a very intense, not angry, but clearly passionate discussion in a way that the Anglo actors wouldn't.
In the storyline of the script, he's very full of balance and nuance, and so this is the thing to do with him. And I'm more like putting a kind of a counterbalance to Jean Marchand's role as somebody very eager to for passion. You know, he's more the reason, and Marchand is the passion. So we play that. Yeah.
It's my first experience in English, to work in English, and the team was so nice. It was a pleasure to play with Colm and other guys, and Jerry is a brilliant director. He knows very well the direction. He has a clear vision of where he wants to go.
No, my friends. Separation benefits to the bureaucrats in Quebec City. Qui veulent se promener avec le flag du Québec planté dans le hood.
Okay, so crowd, once again, very important. No signs, but really a lot of animation. I see everybody here. Okay. Don, say I dare you again.
Come on.
I dare you.
Shut up.
Oh, and he's getting up.
Did I dare you? No. And he died.
Come on.
Oh, oh. What the hell was that?
It's
not brilliant.
No,
it looks like he's not taking it serious.
What's magic about this?
He's got to make the speech.
People want speeches. They want to dance. They want to
change. They know that more than you.
No. They even know what he's going to do if he gets elected.
I'm Patrick McKenna. I play Duncan, a fictitious character in the show. I'm sort of the one that Trudeau gives all his exposition to in order to keep the story moving. So I'm no historical character, so I can play this pretty much any way I want.
It's a huge relief.
I'm really thankful. I keep looking at people coming in and who have consulted with the real life counterparts and feeling a huge sense of relief that I don't have to impersonate anyone and no one will say, he's wrong, he's the wrong, that's not like Green Bomb at all.
Look at the polls. Look at the trend behind the polls.
We got a Bobby Kennedy on our
team. Hustle after him, after him.
He wants to cancel the speech, sir.
Cut. Cool, that was good.
I mean, one of the great things about having a fictional character is you can have any hairstyle at all. My hairstyles radically change through each era, so I feel that story, the history is told through my hair.
Playing a fictitious character is, well, you know that you're never wrong. That's one thing. There's no historical accuracy involved, so that's nice. But the best part is that you know you have a function to do. You have to feed the want of the script. So you just keep plugging into that to set Trudeau up, or whoever it may be, to be able to get their exposition out to move the story along. We just have the status of the characters. I play his personal assistant, so you keep that status in proper of what has to happen. And Don has the position of the propaganda minister, basically, and he keeps that happening. So as long as we have the status and the function of the characters, we can play whatever role we need to in order to breathe life into that function.
Easy, easy. Right.
Pierre drops the boys off at my house, and I'm broke, and he offers me $50 to help take care of the three boys for 6 weeks, and Margaret attacks Pierre, and that's actually based on truth.
Well, gee, Margaret, let's just see what I have here, then. What, $50. Would that be of any help to you? Margaret, stop
that! That does move me, and absolutely was right there with her in the moment. I was really angry about that. Yeah, and that to me sums up a part of the angst in their marriage, you know.
Do you want to be prime minister someday?
He burst onto the political scene in a cloud of charisma.
It was an emotional relationship that we had with him.
He has become an icon. He's one of our heroes.
The Life and Times of Pierre Elliott Trudeau, next on CBC.
He burst onto the scene in a cloud of charisma. A politician like no other.
My name's Pierre.
I'm Margaret.
Canada must be a just society.
How far would you go with that? Just watch me.
I'm a lot older than you are.
Even the people that hate your guts still think you're the right man to lead the country.
When do we take our future into our own hands and say, this is us, here we are?
Trudeau begins tomorrow at 8 on CBC, brought to you in part by Canadian Tire.
Is it your cell phone, Ken? Oh, no way.
It's day 41 of 40.
41 days of filming in the can, $7 million spent. And are we anywhere near the end? Not in your life. Jerry and Dean have to spend 2 months in darkened rooms over editing machines trying to come up with a cut they like. And after that, a cut is approved by everybody else. We spend another 2 months putting music and sound post on it. It's actually a very fascinating part of the whole deal.
The composer's experience is to catch up almost overnight what creative teams have been working months on. And with Jerry being the effervescent person he is, and very vocal, I'm able to pick up from him very quickly what he wants, generally musically for the project, and very specifically for each cue. So in a sense, that takes care of like half of my homework. Actually, this is. Yeah, this is the cry cue.
Yeah.
So I think a little. I think more restrained might be better. Yeah. But lots of tone.
Okay. Rolling Q22.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Right from the beginning of the show, Jerry and I had talked heavily about using music, a lot of, you know, big Canadian hits of the time from the 60s, 70s, and 80s. And I loaded probably close to 400 songs when we started this show. And from there, we, you know, we modeled certain scenes around certain songs, and we play with things back and forth until we found the right songs for the show.
The music in this show, especially the stuff in the first half, we got all this great 60s and 70s Canadian rock and roll stuff. I found that very helpful in kind of in the way I was kind of shaping my stuff to help convey the emotion of each scene or the overall vibe of, you know, the first section of this show. I found I could really feed off that. It gave me a lot of information about what was going on in the director's head when he thought of this stuff, and when they chose the music, they obviously had a lot of stuff in mind. And I found I could really, that really helped me propel, you know, what I was doing.
The first thing we do is basically dump all the audio tracks in from that. After that process, basically each character gets its own track. So Trudeau would always be on track one, Margaret on another. Just facilitates the mix upstairs. After that, basically, I go through all tracks and make sure everything's clean, no clicks or pops, ADR what's necessary or what, you know, needs to be changed. Do all the level corrections so that the dialogue edit actually stands up on its own, at room tone, whatever. When that's done, goes upstairs to the mix theater.
Yeah, the thing that we discovered kind of at the last minute was an interesting sound effect that Lil had cut in, which was the sound of a helicopter, which of course doesn't really make sense in the context of the scene, but one of the things that it allowed us to play with stylistically was keeping the audience away from hearing what was transpiring between Lalonde and Trudeau. Although we knew something was up, it's one of the fun things that you can do is to not reveal everything right away, yet at the same time give a sense of foreboding or dread by using this particular sound effect. And in a lot of ways, sound effects provided something that sometimes music is often underlining or leading us in terms of what we should be feeling or what we should be thinking. And but in this particular show, sound effects actually was helping us out in some of these scenes.
Gentlemen, I'm afraid we'll have to adjourn. The British Trade Commissioner in Montreal has been kidnapped.
By who?
The FLQ.
Again, it's not just dramatic footage. It's dramatic footage and stock footage, plus visual effects, which we're adding in as well, which all have to be orchestrated like really like a symphony. So we've got all the stuff that we actually shot. Then you've got the historical footage. Then you've got the newsreel footage below that. Then we have the level of effects. And then at the bottom, then the final level is a graphic images, titles, words, and things which flash up on screen. So all this stuff has to be woven, and not just seamlessly, but also emotionally throughout the movie.
My role here as on this project was to do the online editing, as well as the color correction and the effects. A lot of times those are separated into various positions. I was actually quite fortunate to be able to do all of them at the same time. It allowed, I think, quite a bit of integration between what the color correct worked, how the color correct worked, and how the effects worked. Jerry Ciccaridi, the director, was very generous in allowing creativity with the various aspects of the production, and hopefully that showed up in the show.
When I first started to design split screens for Trudeau, Jerry was looking for something fun in 60s, and he handed me a stack of magazines and told me to look to fashion for inspiration. So I started flipping through the magazines, and I looked through some old clothes at home, and I found this hairband that had very similar graphic features to these, similar colors, similar shapes, and so I basically, using the hairband as inspiration, designed a multi-screen like this, and I showed it to Jerry, and he thought it looked really groovy.
General idea was that she's getting high, and you have to make it look sort of psychedelic, I think was the word, but was used, so this particular material was never shot with a mat in mind, meaning it wasn't shot on green screen, it was never meant to be composited with many layers. So painstakingly, Corey came in and started cutting a mat around her and put a nice soft edge on it, so we were actually able to separate three layers of video. It was basically her sitting in the bathroom. There's another layer of the wallpaper, which Carrie sort of embellished a bit to give it a psychedelic feel. And then we cut the mat of her sitting on the toilet, which is a sort of another angle of this, which has been flipped. And then when you put them all together, this particular TV effect we have here, Trudeau's talking about his rocky marriage and about how it's affecting his political career.
Just trying to make it look like old TV, and we realized that we could move the lines around to make it look like the picture separating, and I just thought it'd be a good idea is that, you know, just to have it drift and then give the effect as if we're trying to, you know, someone working with rabbit ears to bring the picture back in. And worked out great, and the fact that the country's drifting as we're drifting the picture is excellent. It's a perfect time for it.
Us, we're supposed to keep out our number, work through him. That's the law.
Well, that's what we can get in my hand. There's a man in my son.
It's no risk for a public broadcaster to essentially do the story of one of its most, I think, influential, formidable, and interesting, you know, political figures. That's what we ought to do.
Aside from the pressures of not enough time or money, as usual in any movie, it was an astonishingly easy shoot because the cast was just so locked up in this sort of magical sense of we're doing something extraordinary here on a personal and on a bigger level.
Projects like this, you realize you're doomed right from the beginning. You're not going to please everybody. You can't. So in a way, you just have to let go and say, well, since there's no hope of making everybody happy, you might as well just do the best film you can and let the chips fall where they may. So it's a fascinating process to get into that. And once we started to ride that thing, boy oh boy, it just took off on us. And I think we had a really good time, and everybody who came to the project seemed to come to it with the same sense of, oh my goodness, we better get this one right, or we better do our best work on this one, because there's no excuse for not doing your best on this particular project.
But I was certainly willing to go along on this adventure with Wayne and the CBC and all the other people, Jerry and Colin, who came on later, as much so that I could learn a little bit about the story too. And I guess I'm a little bit more sympathetic now towards Trudeau and his legacy than I was at the time when we started this.